Welcome, Spartans, to the podcast Evolve Book Club, part of the Rated M Gaming Network. I am your host, Aaron, and with me today is Krysta.
Yay! I can read!
And returning super awesome community guest, Chris.
Yay! What?
Howdy, folks.
Yay, and of course, Krysta talks over him. Thank you very much, Krysta.
You're welcome. This is how I greet my guests.
This is terrible.
We're off to a good start.
In case you're joining us and you're trying to remember what book club we were supposed to do this month, last month, it's Shadow of Intent, which is the rather awesome Joseph Staten novel.
Mm-hmm.
Novella.
It's a fake book, although it's soon to be in print.
So it will be, it'll eventually be a real book.
Yes, that means it grew up into a real book.
Uh-huh.
If you're reasonably familiar with this, it came out on the, hang on a minute, have we got the date? Is this the right date or is this an American date?
It's 2016.
It came out on the 7th of the 12th.
Was it 2016? No.
No, it was last year. But sometimes Drew has a terrible habit of putting the dates in the back to front American way and then I get confused.
I will just check for you.
Oh, look, fact checking live on the show. I like that. Well, anyway, I'll carry on in the meantime. It's it's available in digital, soon to be available in print. It's roughly 100 pages, depending on your font size, and it's a pretty good read.
It was released on December 7th, 2015.
That's okay, the date is correct then. It's the right way around. Take that, Drew.
I did it right.
Because he's going to be listening to this with any luck while he's travelling, so he can't reply to me. Ha ha. Right, that's enough being cruel to Drew. So, I suppose we should start with a brief summary of what this book is about. The summary from the back of the book that's on Halo Waypoint says that after decades of grim combat against the humans and then the traitorous Covenant prophets, the Sangheili warrior Ratus Vadam, the Half-Jaw, has earned a long rest, but not all of the prophets perished in the Holy City. And now one of their fearsome prelates has sworn his vengeance. The powerful threat has set a cataclysmic plan in motion, a plan to lure the Half-Jaw into a trap that will herald the utter destruction of the entire Sangheili race.
And you don't really find out about the plan until, like, the last chapter of the book, and they're like, oh, that's what they were gonna do.
It all comes together a little quickly at the end, so I suppose we go over just, like, a quick rundown of what happens in it. We'll not spend too long on it, because, like I said, it's a fairly short book, and if we talk about the summary, we may as well just read it ourselves and do like an evolved audiobook. So the short version is it's the Half-Jaw and the Shadow of Intent. He's off, supposed to be taking it easy, staying away from Sanghelios while they're having the Civil War, because they mention in the book that the Shadow of Intent is the last ship of her kind in the Covenant fleet. Well, it's not the Covenant fleet anymore.
In the Sangheili fleet.
Yes. She's the last one left, so the Arbiter wants it far away from all the fighting, just in case. And I think it's in a bit of a sorry state, because they talk about it in the book, like, they're down to 200 crew members, some of the turrets work, some of them don't, some of the plasma batteries work, and it's not in the wonderful shape it was in during Halo 3 when they turn into the Ark and smash everyone to pieces.
Well, from what I understand, they haven't actually gone home with the ship after the war.
Pretty much it seems to be that way, that they've been out and on mission and one thing after the other, and we already know they've got a shortage of engineers and that, so they just, like, they paint a bit of a sorry state for things.
Well, actually, this actually happens after they return to Sangheilios, because the Arbiter has to get back from after the Voyman Memorial.
Oh, that's true.
Because this book happens after the Voy Memorial, because that they actually go over this in a little bit in the book, saying after the war we got peace and so on.
It's not too long after, because they're still sort of, it seems to be that the fighting's quite severe and they're still pretty deep into it at the minute.
It's not long after the fall High Charity, though. That's what they state directly in the book, though.
So let's see, they end up, the Shadow of Intent responds to a distress call on a colony world of Ranello?
Ranello, yeah.
I can't pronounce it, to be honest.
Let's just go with Ranello.
Ranello.
Yeah, Ranello.
Yeah, so they arrive there, they find the colony's been pretty badly smashed up, they find bodies of dead brutes, and then they eventually come across some of the natives out collecting elite bodies. And they are Tul Duran and her younger brother, who I don't think they ever name, do they?
I don't think
they
so.
They do, but they usually just call him the Kadon. Kaidon.
Yeah, I don't think they ever actually mentioned his name out loud. He's called the Kaidon, and that's it as far
and
as I know.
And honestly, most of the time they call Tuldron a Skion.
I was going with Skion sounded.
So I mean, they're naming the, and they call, of course, they call the Half-Jaw the Half-Jaw instead of,
suppose we should be familiar with it. It's no different than,
yeah,
Chief.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's mostly calling people by titles because names are hard.
So anyway, they arrive there. They come across these people. They learn that a ship attacked with a prelate and some brutes.
I will go on a little bit about the prelates later on.
Yes, because he's quite interesting in this. And there's so much stuff in it that really, for such a short story. But the short version is, these guys came and attacked. They kidnapped some people, including the actual Kaidon and two of Tull's older brothers, meaning that her youngest brother becomes the Kaidon, and she's kind of his master at arms. I think that's the fairest description for her role.
Field master, I think that's kind of what it's like.
It's captain of the guard for the Kaidon.
Captain of the guard, that's what I was thinking of. I was trying to think what they call it in Game of Thrones.
I mean...
Shh, be quiet. So... Tull tells all this to the Half-Jaw, and then he decides with the crew that they need to go and find this prelate and stop him, because he would appear to be one of the dodgy Sanshyum that escaped High Charity, and it's kind of their job now. They get ready to go, and then Tull petitions Radis to be one of his crew.
The important thing about Tull is that it's a Lady Sangheili.
It is, yes.
Yeah.
And normally they are not allowed on ship.
Because this becomes a bone of contention with his first lieutenant. They call him Blademaster, but he's Vol Soren.
He's the guy we all want to be. He dual wields energy
swords.
Yes,
dual wielding energy swords. Yeah. And he's not particularly up for the idea of a woman on the ship. But interestingly, Radis, and I'm going to call him the Half-Jaw from now on just for handies.
Yeah, Half-Jaw is
he
easier.
And I think possibly the most interesting character in this whole book, potentially, an Ungoy called Stolt.
We need more Stolts.
Yes, he
we
sounds like
more
the most
him.
Terrifying grunt. They describe him as this kind of tall, lanky, muscular grunt who's actually one of the rangers on the Shadow of Intent, and he gives orders to the other elites because they follow him, because he's that proficient in combat and terrifying, which I'm utterly kind of intrigued by. Like,
and they barely talk about him either. They like graze over him a couple of times, but the character isn't in a lot of Shadow of Intent.
No, he doesn't get a lot of screen time, but
he's still badass.
Page time?
No, it's screen time. I read it on my Kindle. It's screen time. That works. So I think he and the Prelate are the two most interesting characters, but I couldn't tell you which I like more. I know the Prelate gets a lot more time, but I just like the idea of a badass grunt.
Because you usually see them as like wimps who like just go like scream and are the comedy gold of Halo. And then there's this Ungoy called Stolt.
Yeah, this tall, muscular one that can kick your ass. Sounds quite awesome.
Who, like, I think he made it, like, one-on-one with a Spartan, if I believe correctly.
Yes, he was injured in the fight, but he survived.
He survived a Spartan encounter. And then he started doing drugs, and now he's huge.
He went on steroids after the big bully beat him up. Is that what we're saying?
Yes, that is my fan theory. Completely fan.
So we'll go through the rest of this a little bit quicker. Shadow of Intent takes Tull, and they go off and follow the next distress call that takes them to the colony world of Duran, which has an interesting sun that has some...
It's going supernova, isn't it? Or it's a dying sun, which is releasing a lot of radiation.
It's in like a state of flux, and there's high radiation levels.
Which cause the shields to go down.
Yeah, it's saying that in the script as well, so...
Yeah, and during this whole engagement, Half-Jaw knows it's a trap, he just hasn't figured out what the trap is, but there's like a slingshot maneuver, and the two ships, the Prelate ship and Shadow of Intent end up beside each other, and the Prelate sacrifices his own ship to board the Shadow of Intent by launching into it with the escape pods. So they launch into the crew bays of the Shadow of Intent and then slowly try to fight their way to take the ship over. And a little bit we've glossed over is that in the meantime, the Prelate who is back, who got his orders from the Minister of... We don't get a name for him either, do we? He's the Sansayom, Minister of Preparation. I don't think we actually get a real name for him.
No, Minister of Preparation's the closest. That's the closest I think we'll get.
It's pretty close. His rank is, from what I understand, his rank is pretty close to the Prophet's rank, isn't it?
I think he's like somewhere in the middle. He's middle management.
Yeah, I think that is it.
He was a department head, like, that would probably be the best description of him.
Yeah. And the prelate's like a Spartan. It's like a Sansayom.
He is. This is the part
Spartan
we're going to get to that's awesome. Before the prelate goes to the colony world of Duran, he gets a plan from the Minister of Preparation. They have discovered kind of like the...
a prototype Halo installation.
Yes, prototype. That's the word. So they found this prototype. They've tested it out. They actually tested out on three elites, which turn out to be Tull's father and her two brothers. And it vaporizes them completely. So the Minister of Preparation hatches a plan that he'll send the prelate to steal Shadow of Intent. They're going to mount this prototype Halo in it, and then they're going to head back to Sanghelios and basically wipe out the homeworld. And this is where they reveal some of the backstory to the prelate. Turns out the Minister of Preparation had a forerunner device that allowed them to make genetic modifications. And originally, if you've read Broken Circle, you'll know that the Sansayom are severely inbred, and a lot of them aren't allowed to breed anymore because they make dodgy side effects. And one of these people was the prelate, but then the Minister of Preparation took him and made these genetic modifications to him, and essentially it turns him into the human version of, or the Sansayom version of, I'd say he's probably closest to a Spartan 3, isn't he? He's faster and stronger, but he has this mental edge that can also, like, break him and drive him a bit mad.
Yeah, if he uses it too much.
Yeah, he has this ability to sort of speed up his reactions and essentially slow down time as he perceives it.
He's a Spartan, but he has an on and off switch, basically.
Yeah. So after these modifications, the prelate was able to get a mate and have a child. His wife was pregnant when he went off, and then they got caught in the middle of the civil war, and his ship was engaged in combat with the Halfjaw outside High Charity as the flood started to infect the city. The prelates and the Sansayom were recalled to try and evacuate as many as they could, and this prelate in particular happened to get the distress call from the Minister of Preparation. So he went back to High Charity, fought his way through the elite lines, docked with the station, and was about to go to attempt to rescue his wife and his newborn child, which he still hadn't seen at this point, when the Minister of Preparation appeared and told him that High Charity was a lost cause. The elites had conspired with the Grave Mind to wipe out the ship, and all the Sansayom were dead on the station.
Truly a shame.
Yes, so they end up leaving, and they flee with the rest of the Sansayom survivors, and then they eventually, I think they'd found, they find this prototype after they've fled. That's why it was never used before.
Yeah.
And then they come up with this plan for revenge, and the prelate's going to be the instrument to acquire the ship and get it done. And that takes us back to the prelate and the brutes board the ship. There's a big firefight. They almost succeed, but they're just stopped at the very end. The elites get the upper hand, and it's a close call. The prelate almost kills Tull, except at the last minute the shipmaster steps in and stops him, but it's a touch and go. And actually, I love when they talk about that fight as they're in the ship bay. You know, when he activates his Spartan mode, he turns up the anti-grav belt, and he kind of flies across the ship and slices people with this energy shield that he has. He cuts through their armor joints and basically slices them down, and everyone moves. I imagine it's kind of like bullet time.
Like a sharp, or a sharp jackal shield.
Yeah, that's what it sounded like. It sounded like a Tull version of a jackal shield with just like an edge that cuts through anything. So he slaughters quite a few elites that way, and then he makes a run for the bridge. But like I said, he gets stopped. He's taken hostage. And then there's a little sort of interaction between him and the Halfjaw on the brig, where the Halfjaw tells him, you know, we're not your enemy. I would have saved the Sansayom on High Charity if I could have, and they were alive when your prophet told you they were dead.
Dun, yeah. Dun, dun.
That's one of the big twists.
Yeah, the prelate doesn't really believe him, but he sort of mulls it over. Let's see, they get the navigation details from the prelate's ship, and then they find out about this Halo they find out about the Forerunner installation, but they don't know what it is. So they set up a plan to go there and kill the prophet, or the minister, I should say. He's not a prophet.
Oh, yeah.
So they set up this plan where they have two phantoms and they send them in separately to the Shadow of Intent, that they fly in on remote control towards the station to make it look as if the Praelite was successful. But the minister figures out what they're doing and does like a small powered test fire of the Halo Array at the Phantoms. But it doesn't, I find it weird that it didn't vaporize them, but it causes, they describe it nearly like their brains disconnect and switch off from their bodies. Everyone just shuts down for a bit.
I think it was because they were out of the effective range.
Yeah, they talk about it that Raddus, when he's on the Phantom, he forgets how to talk, he forgets how to understand his language, and it takes him a couple of minutes almost to reboot and figure out what's going on again. Like, they just, it's this painful sort of effect, and then everyone's left a bit vegetabilized almost. It was weird. The other thing to note about that is every time the minister fires this prototype, it's damaged, and it damages a little bit more. So he's using up some of his last shots. You know, he's supposed to be saving it up for the big shot.
Well, it is a prototype.
True. So the Praelite escapes after a little bit of a scuffle, and he injures Stolt in the process. The Halfjaw and Tull follow him. They all jump out of the ship in their EV gear and shoot off towards the space station after him. The Praelite makes it back first, and he confronts the Minister of Preparation and eventually gets it out of him that your family were alive and I lied to you because I wanted to use your anger to fulfill my mission for vengeance.
Dick move.
Yeah, he's a bit annoyed about that, but the minister uses the Yanmeh. Yanmeh, that's right, isn't it?
Yeah, Megan.
Yeah, the drones.
Yeah, the drones.
The drones. Let's call them drones because drones is easier. We all know the word drones.
He has a few of those in the Halo sort of test firing bay with him, so he gets them to attack the Praelite. And he ends up injured. And just as this happens, Tull and Raddus get into the bay, and they're sort of pinned down and slowly taking out drones. And then Tull gets a lucky shot and injures the Prophet, or the Minister. Prophet. Damn it. Stupid.
It's called Minister.
Titles
the,
Minister.
The Minister.
So she injures him, and he flees back to the control room, and he's getting ready to fire the Halo again to kill everyone. And that's when the Praelite, realizing the error of his ways, decides that he can help. And he takes a bag of plasma grenades and throws them down towards the power core. But he gives Raddus and Tull enough time to escape from the station before it explodes. Mm-hmm. And then he wipes everyone out along with the prototype and the minister as well. And so goes the Sansayam Spartan, short-lived.
I hope there's more of them out there.
I'd imagine there are, because this is what they talk about at the end, is that they figured out that there is a fleet of Sansayam out there. And he gets in contact with the Arbiter, and he asks two things. One is that the Arbiter relax the rules on females serving on elite ships.
Which leads on to Halo 5 with females,
yeah, we're one of the
appearing
females
in it.
Yeah.
Kinda appearing.
She kind of talks to us, yeah.
Yeah.
I say that goes there, so that Tull becomes a member of the Shadow of Intent's crew, and I assume she becomes a ranger like the rest of them. And the other thing he says is that rather than take it easy, he wants to take the Shadow of Intent and go in search of this fleet of Sansayam that are on the run to find who in them's worthy of saving and who requires punishment.
Yeah.
And to dole it out accordingly.
Which seems exciting. I really want to see some of these adventures.
Some of them might be in Halo Fractures.
I hope so.
Yeah, that could be a cool sort of story for it. Maybe that'll be the TV show. Remember that thing?
That never happened?
Yeah, The Adventures of the Halfjaw.
Someday.
That's
someday.
A lot of CGI.
Might as well just make an animated series.
Right, so that pretty much covers what happened in it. So what do you guys think? Chris?
We need more stalls. That is my thoughts.
I think we do too. I think more badass grunts is only a good thing. I suppose it's something I probably should have thought about at some point, that there had to be, for every idiot grunt, there has to be a cool one. Like, even think about people, there's loads of scrawny ones, but there are the occasional impressive specimens.
What about that grunt from The Flood, who, like, what did he do? He captured an elite and got off the Halo ring before it exploded in the first Halo?
Well, he just blackmailed him.
Yeah, he blackmailed him, but he still got the upper hand on a Sangheili.
I think that grunt still died.
Oh, he still died?
He did die in the end. Still, he wasn't physically, you know, for a grunt to actually take on a Spartan and live. How many times have you run around a game and just splatted a grunt in the face with the butt of your rifle and that's it?
Every single day.
So the idea that this one was big enough and tough enough to fight a Spartan hand to hand and live
mm-hmm.
is pretty awesome. I think the other awesome character is definitely the Prelate. I like this idea that there were the Covenant equivalent of Spartans.
I mean, before now, we didn't even know that the Sanshaihum even had warriors. Usually, it was always told in the books that the Sangheili were the warriors for the Sanshaihum.
Yeah, because they're kind of a decrepit species. Like, that's the takeaway from, if you read Broken Circle, is if you don't have a chair, you have an anti-gravity belt because you can't walk in normal gravity on your own. They're all frail. Like, the biggest fight that a Sansaim can put up is the equivalent of the Halo 2 boss battle with the plasma cannons. Yeah, you know, they're not physically intimidating.
Though they used to be. Back in the Forerunner times, which is covered in the Forerunner trilogy.
Yes, they were once a
handsome species.
An energetic, like, I suppose they're still young, but they're just so frail now. Like, they were once just
frail, interbred, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, so they're kind of a sorry state, and then suddenly you have this reveal that, well, actually there's a whole other side to this of these powerful, pretty fierce Prelates.
Fun fact though, in the Halo 2 multiplayer map pack guide, manual, there's actually a mention to the Prelates, and this is the first ever mention to the Prelates. Pretty much, the map Genemai, which has like the big statue of the Prophet of Truth in it? Well, that was
the one
like,
in High Charity.
Yeah, the one in High Charity. Yeah, that was where like the Prelates like went to like pray and all that sort of stuff.
Hmm.
That was their first ever mention, and they were never mentioned again till this book.
Yeah, like, only for you mentioning that, I would have completely forgot about it all. It's just such a small, throwaway little section. I suppose it's no different than the Guardians are nothing more, really, than a couple of throwaway mentions for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of things in Halo like that, so it's interesting to see stuff like that come back.
Krysta, what did you think of it? What did you like?
I liked the female Sangheili Tool, or Skion. She has instead of an energy sword, she carries like a spear that has an energy sword tip on both sides of it.
Yeah, it's like this awesome sort of staff.
It's like a lance, right?
Sadly, it nearly put me in mind of the Stormtrooper has in Episode 7, the traitor.
Basically, but it's so cool.
Traitor.
Traitor! I do like how they're incorporating female Sangheili into it, though. It's interesting.
Yeah, because like up until this, the only other mention we've had of a female Sangheili, and she wasn't a warrior, was Jules' wife. What was Jules' wife? Anyway.
Rho, I think.
Yeah, you know the one I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, but like she wasn't a warrior. None of them really were. They mention in the Keel of Five books, they're trained to defend their keep, but that's about the height of it.
Well, there was actually another mention of a female in a war situation. Like, in the Halo Wars launch site, pretty much there was this, like, female who, like, upgraded, like, I think, Banshees, I believe? Weapon Master Sanjik.
And then wasn't there the creepy, slightly human-looking female elite in the Halo Legends?
Yeah,
we
there
can all
was.
Mention that.
Short.
Yeah, that one
that's,
was...
That's the one we don't talk about.
That was strange. Well, I mean, that's when they had, like, skyscraper-tall hunters walking around, but... Also, it's been mentioned that the female elites are more political than anything else. They kind of run Sangheilios, don't they?
They have all the power because they're the people in Sangheili culture. You don't know who your father is, so you can only prove yourself on your own merits, which means that the women know who everyone's father is because they need to stop the inbreeding, basically.
Yeah.
So whilst the males go out and fight, the women are the ones with the real power at the end of the day.
Yeah, they're like the political leaders of Sangheili.
They can stop you mating with someone, you know. They can tell you no. They control everything that's important about it. So like they have power, but it's just nice to see them
fighting as well. Because I mean, the kind of power they have wouldn't be really in a Halo game, because Halo games are all about warriors and fighting.
And it's cool to see them getting around to this. You never stop to think about it, but there's male and female characters in the UNSC, and it's just a given. With the exception of Halo 5, like, you've never seen a female any Covenant in a game, have you?
No,
nope.
I think all the grunts are male, all the brutes are male, I think some of the jackals are female.
We don't see a female jackal, though, in the games.
Yeah, I don't think it, like, I've never seen any as the
it's
hunters
only,
don't have a...
It's only in the expanded universe up to
Halo
5.
Okay.
You know, so it would be nice to see more of that, to see jackal shipmistresses fighting, you know, like a boss battle or something, that sort of thing.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
So, like, it's cool to see it, and I have to say, like, that I know I've gone on about it, but it's quite a good book, and it's, like, a pretty cool return for Joseph Staten, like, just coming back into the Halo universe again after being gone for so long that...
And it's a quick, it's like a plane book. Like, you know how you get on a plane and you can just read this book in a plane flight.
Yep, like, I read this in one go. I just didn't stop, didn't sit it down. Like, there's the odd time reading some of the books where I'll be like, that's enough for tonight. We're just going to just give up now.
Yeah, but it takes like an hour to 2 hours to finish it.
Yeah, and it was just one of those ones speed. I didn't want to put it down. So even if something had to come up, I'd have just kept going. Yeah,
this one was one of my favorite books of 2015, though.
I think it's definitely up there. I don't know. I don't think I've given it enough thought to decide what my favorite book of last year was, but I think maybe this and Broken Circle might be high up there. Like, I know, I think I was a bit cooler on Broken Circle at the time, but I've warmed to it since then.
Yeah, I really like these novellas that Halo is now coming out with, because it's just a quick read. It introduces something interesting into the universe, and it's not as time consuming as one of their bigger novels, and they can release more of them.
Yeah, although I suppose they're not really doing that as much this year now that we're getting Fractures, you know.
We're just gonna get them all in Fractures, but that would be interesting if they released. We're getting this, and we're getting Saint's Testimony in that as well, so we got a taste of Fractures beforehand, but it'd be interesting if they broke up Fractures a bit more and released some of the stories beforehand and then came out with the book.
I don't know, they might do that, but then again, that some people might just accuse them of trying to make people double dip.
You pay to read the content early.
I don't know, I can't see it. Yeah, I'd say we'll probably be made to wait for that. But anyway, we're getting off track again.
Yeah.
Back to this book. So is there anything you didn't like?
In a book this short, it's hard to find things that you don't like, because there's not one of those, like, in a long novel, you'll have the, like, three or four chapters that are just setting everything up. In a book like this, everything is set up really fast, and there's not any downtime. It's mostly just interesting information and action.
Yeah, I think my biggest complaint, and it's not much of a complaint, is probably that it was so fast that there's just... I wanted a little more detail, you know, like, the fact so many people, or quite a few of them, we don't get a name. Things just kind of bounce pretty quickly. Like, this all... It feels like the sort of thing happens in the space of maybe 2 days. I don't think there's a definite time scale, but it's just this little quick, it's there, it's gone.
That's 2 days sounds about right, from when they arrive on the colony world
till they get in the trap till the end of the book.
Yeah, I do wish there was like a, oh, this is the date this happens, and I just wish that they stopped doing that in the Halo books for a while. Just like, oh, let's just stop putting accurate dates. Let's just say the month and the year, and that's all we'll do.
It probably saves them getting trapped in any problems down the line if they don't give dates for everything. But
years and months are nice. I mean, specific days aren't exactly necessary, because I mean, usually they'll say when a character goes to sleep and wakes up the next morning, or is very tired because they've been fighting for a long, long time. Because, I mean, they did spend the night on the colony world, didn't they? They went back to the keep.
I think so.
But still, I suppose it all takes over pretty quick. I have to say, actually, the other thing, just while I think of it, that I really liked about this book is the two or three dream sequences that the Prelate has.
Oh, they're very good.
Yeah, those were really cool.
Like, he does a really good job of sort of vividly painting this nightmare scenario where... I think the Prelate says that every time he has the dream, he gets a little further and a little closer to his family before he wakes up. And over and over and over, he has this dream that he gets there, and the flood, I think the first time he finds his family, the flood take over and kill his wife and child in front of him. The second time he gets to the family, he stops the flood, and then the elites, and I think it's the Half-Jaw himself, burst through a window to try and stop them.
Eventually he realizes that no matter what happens and what he does in the dream, is that he'll always fail.
He's always doomed, yes, because there's one point where he grabs the baby and he uses his anti-grav belt to fly up into the air to the top of the dome, and even then he doesn't manage to make it.
I like how they went back and forth between... There's just so much detail to the Prelate that they could have left out, but it's really nice to have to understand who he is and even how he works.
Yeah.
Since we've never been exposed to a prelate before.
Yeah, and they explain his powers and everything else. Like, they do give him, like, a Spartan level of detail about it.
Yeah.
You know who he is and what makes him tick, like he could be...
Also, another nice thing about this book is that everyone has a motive to be doing something.
Yeah.
It's not like, oh, I'm just here because I'm supposed to be. They literally give everyone a motive of what they're doing and why they're doing it.
It's all believable. Like, you could understand that a minister would want vengeance for the loss of High Charity at whatever the cost.
Or, like, Tool wants to kill the minister for killing her family.
Yes, and that the shipmaster wants to track down any of the Sansium left and try and find any of the prophets, potentially.
And any he of knows these ministers. Also, he's very interested in getting the prelate because he knows how dangerous the prelates are.
It's overall, like, it's a good book. I enjoyed it. I liked it. I think it's well worth buying. Although I'd say at this stage, if you haven't bought it, it's maybe worth holding off for Fractures.
Yeah.
Though it's not very expensive, isn't it? Just a couple bucks.
No, it's
on Amazon?
Yeah, it's only a couple of quid here as well. It's pretty cheap. But if you're the sort of person that really likes a paper copy at this stage, you know, well, then again, I suppose if you've listened to it at this stage, you've hopefully already bought it and you haven't listened to this without
really
it.
Or else you don't really need to read it at this point.
This novella reminded me a little bit of Contact Harvest a little bit. I mean, like, Contact Harvest goes into, like, well, it went into the Kighar a little bit, and it just explored stuff that we didn't go into in other media previously. So this one went into the prelates and the side.
I suppose all that stuff, yeah, about Johnson's past and his grandmother. Is it grandmother
or
his aunt?
Contact Harvest gave us a lot more alien perspective. I mean, we got to learn more about the brutes and we got to learn more about the jackals from Contact Harvest.
True.
But this isn't Contact Harvest.
I know, I was just saying it reminded me a little bit of it.
Right, well, I think we've kind of covered everything. It's a good book. We all like it. It's well worth reading. There's fun stuff in it. Interesting characters, and it adds a little more detail, and I can't help but feel like hopefully someday it might be a little setup for the return of the shipmaster in some shape or form.
I hope so.
I'd like to see the Half-Jaw and the Shadow of Intent come back someday, maybe at Halo Wars.
Well, we know about the Shadow of Intent, like, we know what it does up to, I think, about 2558, so it's still around, it's not destroyed yet.
No.
In current Halo media.
I'd like to see him make a return. Like, I could see it. It's the kind of thing could come back in maybe Halo Wars. What do you think?
Yeah. I mean, maybe. We haven't gotten a concrete story of what Halo Wars is about, have we?
And see, the problem with 343 is because so many things now hint at future stuff, I'm just here pulling the red string across the wall trying to work out all the connections, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I end up going really far down the rabbit hole being like, what is this? Could this mean this? Could that mean, you know, what does this lead to? So in my head, I'm never treating something as just its own little short story. I'm now looking at this going, what does this mean for the future? What's coming next? But like, even if it leads nowhere and we never hear from Radus and the Blade Master and the rest of his crew and Stolt ever again, I'm quite happy that he got this.
No, I think Half-Jaw needs a good finale if they continue him on. He's from Halo 2, and I mean, that is a very long history that we have with this character, so this ending him off here would be a little bit weird, per se.
It might be, but then again, it wouldn't be the first time that they've just sort of left a character in vague limbo, so I'm not sure. I'd like to see him back, I really would. I think he's an interesting character, and especially at the time when he existed, there were very few interesting Elite and Covenant characters.
Yeah, I do have to agree with that. I mean, we even got a whole story dedicated to how he lost half his face.
Very true.
Yeah.
Right. I think we've covered everything.
Any last minute thoughts? No?
We still Closing need thoughts. More salt.
Yes, I want a
salt. More salt. More ladies.
What I want is I want like a warrior cult of grunts. I want the people Stolt come from, you know. I want to have a story about, like, his warrior family.
My god, that'd be terrifying. Just imagine
the history, yes,
them off in the game.
The history of the Stolt line and how terrifying they are.
Just these mutant grunts.
I love it. I would love to see grunts like this in Halo in the future, just to play with the idea of what you'd expect. Like, imagine just playing Halo 6 as a Spartan 4 and you're going, oh no, the grunts are coming in, and then this thing comes out of a drop pod somewhere and runs at you.
That'd be terrifying.
And smashes your face in with his giant, calloused, super crushing fists.
I hope that happens, because that'd be terrifying the first time you just see it.
And the mere fact that he can run and he doesn't waddle places is terrifying. You know, he has like proper legs with knee joints. Like, anytime you see a grunt, they just sort of, they waddle frantically from somewhere.
Now I'm gonna have nightmares about this mutant grunt.
Super grunt. Right, well, I think that'll do us for this week. I do apologize for keeping you waiting. Lots of stuff happened. David murdered his microphone. That was probably the single biggest thing that delayed this episode. Shout out to David. Hello.
Hi, David.
Hello.
Your microphone's dead, but your headphones are not.
You're still with us at heart.
Yes, and if you're listening to this, we do plan on very shortly having Cryptum as our next book, but considering we're like 3.5 weeks late on this one, please don't hold me to that. Please. All right, that'll do us for this week, and we'll see you all again. Evolved.
Evolved.